Hello and welcome. Today we are at Gtechniq HQ in Northampton?
Yeah, Northampton, just Junction 16, just off the M1. Yeah.
They've pretty much got their own junction now. There's a whole new road, which is called the Gtechniq bypass.
We tried to get it called XO Avenue, but they weren't having it. Did try. Not having it.
So I'm joined here by Rob Earle, who is the man at Gtechniq. Are you CEO?
MD. MD.
That's good. Yes, MD always strikes me good in a smaller company. Rather than CEO, it sounds like you've got a million people under.
Not yet.
And I really wanted to do a quick interview, really, on how it goes at Gtechniq, the new products we've got going, the new systems that are
sure.
in place.
Yeah.
So give us all a little background. I'm sure all our readers have and watchers know about Gtechniq, have heard about Gtechniq.
I'm sure. where have you been? So we've been going, it's now since 2001. I've been involved since 2004 and just been growing, you know, product line. When I started in 2004, we had C1, P1 and C3, and now we're up to, I think we're about 40 odd different products. I can give you the whole sales pitch.
But you're a specialist in really ceramic. You do all the maintenance products.
Yeah, that was the initial thing. C1 was the first product that really kind of brought us to a lot of people's attention. Yeah.
And back in 2001, hell, even in 2010, the concept of ceramic coatings were a little newfangled.
Yes.
And you've been among the most instrumental companies in terms of bringing that to popular awareness.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. I think. Now consumers are now kind of realizing what ceramic coatings do, the durability they can get out of it. They get longer from a detail, and you know, really that's what the consumers want. So I think, you know, the market has shifted quite considerably towards that.
It certainly is focusing very much on the new car protection side.
Yes.
I know some people, there's even a hashtag called wax is dead, I think it's carbon collective or something.
Ceramic probably do a lot in the States, but it's not. But
exactly.
No, there is a market for it.
Absolutely. So I think it's about the enthusiast versus professional market. And also new cars versus sort of old cars.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in, you know, the classic, yeah, we do all the RM auctions in Europe, and we've never had a single customer from that. And that's with all the, you know, the kind of 15 million quid Ferrari. Those guys, I think when you got the more traditional paint system, they're happier to go with, I mean, coatings work, but they're happier to use more traditional products.
I can absolutely imagine that. So we've mentioned here in the, what's the official term? Gtechniq Detailing Centre?
Gtechniq Works.
And this studio, you might have seen it in issue 4 or 5, I think it was, we came to the launch ceremony.
Yeah.
And this sort of studio is amazing. Above us we have a massive flat LED panel, and there's all sorts of things right down to the bins being colour-coded to suit with the black paperwork.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a cool place, isn't it?
Thank you. Yeah, it's come out really well, really happy with it.
And what I like is it's very much a working environment. What you might not be able to see is there are skid marks on the ground. This is every day is being used for either training or doing some detailing, and it's not just for display purposes.
Absolutely. It was one of the things that I wanted to have. We started, you know, way back in 2004. It was 1,500 square foot, and half of that was dedicated to detailing. And then the next move, I decided to not have a detailing section, simply because I needed to focus more of my attention on building the product line. But actually, I really felt, because we didn't have a centre, I felt very handicapped in a way that we couldn't actually run a lot of the in-house testing and just get that kind of evaluation. You can only really get that doing, one car is fine, but you've really got to kind of be applying products for a long period of time on a lot of cars to actually kind of see firsthand any kind of glitches there are, any application issues and things like that.
So you do a lot of testing in the house?
Absolutely, yeah.
And next door, there's a huge warehouse area, and it is full of where you're doing all your labelling and by the looks of it.
Yeah, labelling and bottling. We do a little bit of mixing here, but the majority of it isn't done here.
And so I'll do some cutscenes and stuff behind the scenes. Yeah. Gtechniq works, as long as I'm allowed to. So, moving on to new products. So obviously, ceramics were cool and sexy. I mean, they still are to an extent.
But they're still very sexy.
More recently, PPF has also come into the fore. I mean, PPF's been around for yonks.
Yeah, no, I mean, PPF, the growth in that market has been extraordinary. The amount of our accredited network now that have got a PPF brand on it, it's just, it's night and day difference. Even 2 years has made it, it's a huge difference. Yeah.
And one thing that's really interesting is that there's a lot of demand out there for coating, as in ceramic coating, of PPF. So you've got your your paint, you then put the clear coat on there to protect it, you then put the PPF on there to protect it, and then you put the ceramic coating on there. So frankly, cars are near on armoured at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, the coating on the PPF, and we, you know, we have now approval with one of the large brands, Eastman.
Eastman are Lumar and Suntech, who are both, they're kind of the two, I mean, there are three or four big ones.
Yeah, I think they're top, I think they're either first or second in terms of volume.
Yeah.
Anyway, we've done a lot of work with them, and the coatings work very well in terms of improving lifespan. And I mean, the big thing is about making films easy to maintain. So it's about dirt ingression being easy to remove, dirt not sticking to the surface as well. Everybody loves to see the hydrophobic, the beading off the film, which is, you know, it is. We'll come into that. I think we're going to talk about that.
But
just a general, from a maintenance point of view, and also, you know, the surface, because film can feel a little bit, because it's quite a non-solid type of surface. It doesn't feel very nice to the touch. Whereas if you put the coating on it, we make it feel a lot more paint-like, a lot slicker. And people really like that, so that's actually going well.
Well, the big news is, and that'll date when we've done this interview, is that you bought out a new product today.
Yes,
which we cheated. Yes, we cheated slightly and mentioned it in the last issue 8.
First Halo.
It's Halo.
Yeah,
but we're going to do a bit more fanfare about that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's Halo, and it was released at SEMA, and I know last week you were in the States as well doing a.
We had our we called it a Serum Summit, which is a big. Well, we had. I think about eight or nine different vendors, a series of workshops, and then a day of talks as well. But it's a much more kind of relaxed environment, and, you know, Gtechniq North America, Andrew and Eric did a fantastic job organising it. It was about 200 people. So we had it out then. We had a bit of a delay on getting this out. We had a few more revisions that we didn't think were going to work, but actually one of them worked extremely well. So in terms of one of the tests we may show the machine later, is we have a scrub test machine, and this formula, our cutoff for performance was around about 4,000 to 5,000 cycles on this machine, using a very, very strong alkaline and then a very strong acidic chemical to test the performance. Which we did, but then this formula actually went to 10,000 without dropping off at all. So, in terms of durability,
you're already at V2.
Yes. And I didn't really want to kind of release V1 and then 3 months later issue V2. So we thought we'd go straight to that one.
And so, can this be applied, I imagine, by Gtechniq accredited detailers?
It's a consumer product, so anybody can apply it. Just sorry to give you more marketing of Gtechniq, but when we're looking at products, there's three things we look at. We look at price, ease of application, and performance. So those are the three most important things when it comes to when we're looking at, particularly for coatings. So this one, one of the things, it has to be relatively easy to apply. This one, happy to say, you know, one of the constraints you've obviously got with films, you can't then get a buffer and really cut to, if you've got high spots, you get left behind. Whereas this product, you can leave it for depending on the environment, but a significantly longer than you ever would for a normal coating, and the high spots you can still remove them. So that's been a real boom for that.
So if you've got a PPF coated car, you can go into, you can buy online at Gtechniq shop and your resellers.
Yes. Yeah.
And you can apply it to your own, or of course get a detailer to do it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
And I heard whisperings that you might be doing the marine range as well.
Back
up again.
This is just the packaging for it. So marine is in the works. I think I gave a commitment at the Serum Summit. We're going to have that out by the end of May.
It's a very light product.
Airy bonnet. we're focusing, so there will be a pro product for that. Marine, you have different requirements there. Obviously, you know, kind of scratch resistance is not a massive thing on marine, but the big thing is anti-UV. So the product that we have is the pro only, so we have a pro only product for marine that has, you know, the strongest anti-UV filter that we could possibly put into a product. But then we have the rest of the product, so we have then a kind of a spray-on, wipe-off type of a coating that will be consumer line, and then we have some other quite innovative on the coating side of things. as well as we've re-engineered the fabric coating. So we've got, we put in a very, very strong anti-mold and anti-mildew additive into that.
So that's for sales, I would imagine.
For sales, for, yeah, because a lot of the times you get on interiors, people will just close up their boats and go away for the winter, and the inside when they come back will be covered in black mildew. So this will be very effective at that, and then durability-wise, it's a big step up from anything that we've done before.
And those coatings, you're saying that they're pitched very much towards the UV side.
Yes.
Have they worked with anti-foul and with salt water?
We're not recommending anything below the waterline. With salt water, above the waterline, not a problem. So yeah, no issue with that. Again, you know, the coating itself bonds chemically to the gel, so in terms of, you know, it's not coming off, or to the marine top coat. And then, you know, the other issue then, and we're tweaking our water spot remover, is then getting water spots off, because sometimes, you know, those salt water spots can be very, very difficult to remove.
That's absolutely. Yeah. And so that works on GRP by the sounds of it.
GRP and yes.
Wood.
Well, you could use it on varnish wood. I mean, it will bond fine to it. I mean, we're more aiming it towards, we haven't got a specific product for varnish initially, but it will be gel coat and polyester urethane marine top coat, or what they use, all grips, the one they normally use. And we've got a lot of experience with that. I mean, we've been working, I pretty much started marine in 2004, so we've got a lot of experience with that, and actually the polish that we've developed for marine in terms of removing oxidation is phenomenally quick.
I imagine it has to be quite aggressive.
Not really, okay. Weirdly not. There's a bit of a secret on how we do that, but in terms of...
Does it involve rubbing?
But we've got, I mean, it's old school, so we're using, kind of 180mm polishing pads. So we've got, and we're now kind of fine tuning on which types of, so it's wool or a synthetic wool blend in terms of the pad. So it'll be a two pad system, but in terms of removing oxidation quickly and without holograms, it works very, very well.
Brilliant. Well, that sounds fun. So boaties, if you have a yacht or a motorboat, have a look at the Gtech site when the marine comes out. So I'm guessing, is it going to be ready for release soon?
Well, we've booked a stand at the Southampton Boat Show, so we've got to get it done by that. But we want to get it done by the end of May. The product development's done. It's now, you know, we're now kind of doing packaging, so the packaging's pretty much done, so it's wording on that. It's those kind of things that are, you know, the kind of slightly more tedious aspects of it. But yeah, that's all being done already.
What are those companies called that sell at dockyards and boatyards?
Chandleries.
Yeah. I'm guessing that's a target.
That's, yeah, very much so. Very much so.
Cool. So moving on from the boaty environment.
Yeah.
One thing that we've been discussing, so we've gone over and had a lovely lunch, we've been discussing the new car protection market. Specifically, dealer new car protection.
Yeah.
Now, many of you, I'm sure, will have heard of brands like Superguard, for example, like Autoglim, Lifeshine, and in fact, our mega test for the next issue, which is issue 9, is going to be testing all of these against each other to see what they're like. And I came on to Rob, and Rob does something called Platinum, which has been out for a good few years now, is it?
We've been doing it in Australia now that's been out in Australia for probably about 6 or 7 years.
Wow.
And we've got it in places like Abu Dhabi Motors in Abu Dhabi, they're the biggest Rolls-Royce and BMW dealership in the world. And the UK, the program has only really been going properly now for it's about 2 years now.
2 years. Yeah. And so the idea, and you're focusing very much on high-end dealerships.
Yes.
At the moment.
Yes.
And the idea is that in the old days, you would get a coating, which would most likely be a polymer coating, like what you can get in the shop.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then you've got some that's a polyxylene, I've seen.
There are one or two, yeah.
And then you can, of course, go for a full professional ceramic coating. So you could do Gtechniq crystal serum black or something like that.
Yes, ultra with that, so yeah.
But for some people, they want it to be easier to apply, and you know, ultra, that's a premium product.
Yeah.
So platinum is, I'm thinking in my head at least, as a halfway house, it is a genuine ceramic.
Yeah, I mean, if you think of it, it's good, better, best. I mean, best is always going to be what you get through the accredited detailer.
Yeah.
Better is, we're doing something better, and I think, the performance of the product is, it's working working very well. And then there's consumer product as well.
Gotcha. Yeah. And I know with certainly within the trade, from the trade association point of view, the new car protections applied by dealers are sometimes bedeviled because and they get the car 3 months after it's come out of the dealership. The customer's saying, oh well, I've had it protected, it should be fine. And they wash the car and they put water in. There's no hydrophobicity. There's no sign of any protection. Now, it's quite a contentious topic, so we're going to trip
sure
because Rob's promised me he doesn't want to go to prison, and I'm not liking him either. But essentially, it's my opinion, my belief,
yes,
that almost all of the new car protection products are pretty good, to be honest, if they are applied properly to a well-prepared car, and the person applying it, a dealer validator normally,
yeah,
has been given the time, the equipment, the training, the knowledge, the experience in order to do it. Now, that is where sometimes things fall down.
Absolutely.
Whereas what Rob's trying to do is actually to get much more in the way of a quality of service as well as a quality of product.
Absolutely.
But one thing that's interesting is in the detailing trade, particularly in enthusiast detailing, if it's not hydrophobic, it's not protected. That's a fact. But in the real world, outside of that little microcosm, you can have protection on the product, and it could be hydrophilic, as in it kind of lures water, and it's not beading. You get kind of sheeting. Could you tell me why? Because platinum is one such product. It's not massively hydrophobic.
No.
The hydrophobicity will fade quickly, but the protection is still there.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, hydrophobic properties, that you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. I mean, just as an example, on marine, we had a very strongly hydrophilic product. It was for water lines of yachts, particularly in the Med, where you get a lot of oil that's because you don't have a tide, you get a lot of oil in the harbours, and you get kind of a horrible scum line around the boat where the oil's just been lapping on the side of it. We produced a hydrophilic coating for that, worked extremely well. You don't want a hydrophobic thing, you want the water to sheet off.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went to we tried selling it out to the car market. I think we sold 2 bottles of it because everybody went, it doesn't bead, it doesn't work. So yes, it's a difficult one. And everybody knows, I mean, you know, hydrophobic, you know, lovely beading, it's a great thing. I like it, I have it on my car, even though I know actually I will have something hydrophilic on there. The issue you have when it's a dealer type of a product is that if you make it massively hydrophobic, and then, for example, it's normally springtime when you get a lot of pollen landing on the car and you have rain showers and it dries out, you get water spots. And then you have, you know, for example, if you're Porsche, Leicester, or wherever you are, you'll then suddenly get 5 customers down for, this stuff is terrible, I've got water spots all over my car. And you're thinking, well, you know, that's not something that you really want to have the dealer principal have to deal with. And more likely than not, they'll tell, say, Gtechniq, off you go.
Yeah.
So we've looked at the specifics of what that market works, what will work on that market, and so having the most massively hydrophobic product wasn't, in our opinion, the best the best solution. Having said that, you know, a lot of the dealers say, it's not as hydrophobic as we've known from other products. What can you do? So we now actually, free of charge, we provide C2 V3 in there. We have a whole kind of sheet in
C2 V3,
the liquid crystal. It's a spray, and that is, you know, you get a contact angle of 110 degrees on that. And that, you know, the customer can apply that themselves. We have a whole extra piece of literature in there about boost the beading, so you can explain to the customer about hydrophobic properties.
So really it boils again down to education, because again, a lot of people, and even within the professional circle, are saying, you know, there's no beading, there's no protection.
Well, it's a tough one. And then, you know, then when we get into, you know, how do you then measure surface energy, we have to get into dyne test pens, and, you know, dyne test pens, they're not cheap, and they're quite difficult to measure. So it's, yeah, it's always a tough one. It's a tough one.
Absolutely. So what you're trying to achieve really is to offer people a dealer-based protection rather than necessarily a third-party detailer system, but one that is of a higher grade.
Correct. Correct. And that's something, you know, we are, and you know, those accredited detailers, GTEC accredited detailers will know this, and some others will know this, is that we're trying to involve the detailing trade within the dealership world. And a lot of people think they're an anathema to each other. They're not, and you know, you will, I think, in the next few years suddenly realize that they're not. Dealerships do now understand detailing because they've had their backsides kicked a lot about it. They do not like seeing cars going out of their dealerships with the dealer wrapper on, going to a detailer. They hate seeing that. They go, that's money going out of my dealership.
It's lost revenue to them.
And so I think you know that some detailers won't want to work with a dealership, some will. And that's, you know, that's the area that we're working We're working on that.
It's a tough balance because on the one hand, you've got the dealers who are obviously looking for profitability now. In the old days, the coatings that were sold, the protection products, were often chucked in with a sale. They might be listed at $500 to $700, but they were chucked in.
Yeah, no, but so, yeah, they still are. I mean, and that's the thing that we're seeing now is that a lot of dealerships are saying, well, not only have our conversion rates gone up, but we're not having to chuck this in as an incentive on sale. We're actually able to sell this. So in terms of revenue, their revenues are going, you know, they're doing well out of this. So they're really happy with it. But we're mindful that we really want to raise standards there.
So essentially before, it was just like an extra cost. They wanted it as cheap as possible, as little time to put on, because ultimately they weren't making money. Now by turning that into a revenue stream, so essentially it was previously a commodity and the luxury side was offered by the independent detailer. By offering it as a bolt-on option that you pay extra for, it's still a luxury item, but customers will demand more of it, both in terms of product performance and in terms of service.
And the customer's becoming savvy. They now are starting to know what a well-prepared car looks like. There's enough people out there, and again, we're talking kind of Porsche, Lamborghini, Ferrari, Aston Martin kind of customers. They kind of know what a well-detailed car looks like, and they're demanding it. And then, you know, the dealerships, a lot of the dealers going, hey, we don't know how to do it.
Yeah.
But we are now seeing that they you know, they're demanding training, they're wanting to improve standards. I think there's going to be a sea change.
Detailing bays is the other thing, is that, you know, in some high-end dealerships now, you go in and there's a big glass wall where you can see all the mechanics tinkering away. It's not going to be long until you get decent high-quality detailing bays, which are an important part, particularly when doing ceramic coatings and lighting and humidity control and the rest, actually in-house. So certainly the prediction from Robert, and I do agree with this, is that dealers are going to up their game, but to be in on it, the detailers themselves, independent detailers, need to make a decision. And if they are going to get on side with the dealers, they can absolutely stand their ground in terms of how much they charge and the rest of it, but it will require an element of investment from them, I suppose.
Yeah, no, they need a commitment. And you guys, be on board. I mean, there will be a demand for, you know, a good skill set. They are now realizing they can't, you know, they can't pay, I don't know what they're giving, they're chucking an extra fiver in to do a protection and saying you've got to do it in 30 minutes. Those days are starting to go.
Yeah.
They are starting to go.
Certainly with my PBD hat on, the sooner they go, the better.
Yes, absolutely. And I think, you know, I think it's only because that is what, you know, a sales manager, a business development manager within a dealer, that's the only thing they've known. They haven't known anything else. Now they suddenly see, we've got to show them what better looks like. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that's going to be a long process.
Yeah, it is indeed. So there are a couple other things I wanted to touch on briefly. Now, people might be six of back teeth with the ceramic coating debate, but we have talked to Florian. You're just a bit weird. So at Florian at Mannix, we talked to Craig at CarPro, and both of those were explaining. So Florian's thrust, and in fact, so was with Craig, was things like the hardness ratings and how, you know, with Craig, for example, he says their coating adds an H or two hardness to whatever was there before.
That's quite right.
Then you've got Florian, who had his, he got this expensive pencil test thing out, and we played around with it and stuff like that for about an hour, and then at the end he said, well, it's all a waste of time. How many times are you going to put a pencil on the side of a car? So then we come to Mr. 10H.
I would say I would agree very much is that, you know, you've got 100 microns and you've got 100 microns of 3B on the pencil hardness test rating paint. Let's get out of this thing of any coatings doing like 10 microns. They just don't. They're 1 micron at the most. Well, you know, what is 1 micron of very hard ceramic going to do to 100 microns of butter softness paint? Craig's probably right in saying that, look, it's probably going to add another couple of 2 points on the pencil hardness test. That's about the most you can ever expect from it. And actually, probably, you know, I think it's a combination of things with ceramic coating. So it's a combination of factors. Yes, the hardness is important, but also it's, you know, the fact that the surface is going to be easier to clean, and you're going to have to clean it less often. All those things contribute towards keeping the surface swirl free for longer, and that's really the net result. But the reality is that unless it's on completely kind of non-metallic blacks and very dark colours, most people don't really notice. Most customers don't really notice the little swirl marks. Mm-hmm. I know you guys do, but a lot of customers don't. They want to see the hydrophobic properties, and that is kind of the,
so when I get asked about the 10H, because we do, again, from the PVD point of view, people phone up, so I've got this 10H coating,
yes.
And I saw an advert with a rhino on the roof of a car.
But I think
the best way of explaining it, I think they're great, but the best way of explaining it, I think, is relative. So if you've got something that's claiming to be 7H and something that's claiming to be 10H, you can rest assured that while neither may actually provide that surface on a soft paint, relative to each other, that gives you an idea of
weight.
That's how I think about it.
Yeah, and it does, I mean, yeah, we can show some panels. I mean, you know, if you wash a non-metallic dark colour with patches of product on there, you can see there is a difference, and quite a marked difference between something like Ultra and, you know, a kind of run-of-the-mill.
An eBay special.
Yeah, but that kind of thing.
That brings us on to another topic that we were going to touch on briefly. And again, a lot of people, partly in confidence actually, Rob's had the balls to come out and say, actually, I want to talk about this, is what we would call a proper ceramic versus something that says ceramic on it. And we're coming across this a bit now. We've got a lot of products using ceramic as a keyword.
It's become very, I mean, you see a lot of big brands now that, I mean, I've just seen in the States, there's, I'm not going to mention names, but, you know, mainstream brands saying they've got a ceramic spray that has 9H on it.
This is
that's interesting.
And it's problematic from a professional point of view, because, again, we've got people who, you know, you've got a bottle and you say you apply this and it's a ceramic coating. And the difficulty is, you're following as a professional, you're following the bottle saying this is a ceramic coating, passing it out to the customer. The customer thinks they've got ceramic coating. It's not, it's a spray sealant with some element of SiO2.
Exactly. It's got inorganic elements, SiO2, in there. And that's something actually, you know, we're going to be working on hard this year is to, I'll probably take some videos upstairs of, you know, showing the differences between ceramic coatings. It's very easy just to say, oh, it's just got a ceramic coating on it. I don't know. I mean, the performance differences are substantial. I mean, they really are. And that's from a kind of a swirl resistance, that's from a, you know, I think again, the main thing is, you know, if when we're putting things like XOV4 on Ultra or on CSL, you know, the performance you get on the hydrophobic is really, really, really strong.
XO, for those who don't know, it's what I tend to call a topper. So you put your ceramic coat on, and then the XO on top. It doesn't last as long as the coat underneath on purpose, as in it's...
But what's interesting about it, and actually we did a lot of, Kelly at KDS, who many of you will know, we did a lot of work with him on just showing also the difference between different clear coats. So if you get a high solid clear coat versus a standard medium or low solid clear coat, the difference in performance you get from something like XOV4 in terms of the hydrophobic performance, it's massive, massive, massive difference. It can be twice the performance on a high solid clear coat than you will on a normal one. The role of something like Serum Light or Ultra or Serum or Platinum that you put on first, a lot of that is actually making a much denser surface. So then, something like XOV4 will work significantly better on that than it would directly onto, let's say, a medium solid clear coat.
So you're kind of preparing it. That sounds good. So without naming names, when you were saying things that truly aren't ceramics, claiming to be ceramics, it wasn't a willy waving for Gtechniq. It was actually saying, there are number.
It doesn't really say anything. You're just saying it's an inorganic coating. I mean, it doesn't really tell you anything about it.
And then, because there are lots of other companies that do produce genuine hardcore ceramics and stuff like that.
Yes.
So, do you think you almost need to invent another term and then copyright the hell out of it and have it as almost like a hallmark that can be applied to ones that
I don't know. I don't know. I mean, that's what we'll be doing. And it's just really trying to kind of educate the market. Because I think a lot of the time, through no fault of a lot of people, will apply a coating and they will never see that car again. How do they know how that's going to be performing over 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 years? And that's the kind of thing that, you know, we spend an inordinate amount of time in the lab and real world tests, just really trying to get under the hood of performance of various coating combinations, etc. So I think that's going to be quite interesting.
And another final thing, I believe we're going to have a tour around in a bit, we'll have lots of cut footage and stuff to get me ding-dong on a gimbal, and that's not a euphemism, is that you are going to be bringing out a series of how-to videos soon.
Yes.
To help really with the maintenance product. So now we are a very video world and all that. So now in the future, you'll be able to, when you get your Gtech product, you'll then be able to go onto your website and YouTube, I would imagine.
So we're trying to kind of don't know, we try to obviously sell the product. But it's kind of so people can understand, you know, why use W5 citrus all-purpose cleaner versus a kind of a standard TFR, which is kind of chock full of sodium. You know, you can make a lot of products. There's a lot of things like snow foams on the market that are just chock full of very, very inexpensive salts like sodium hydroxide. Works very effectively, but it's, you know, it's pretty aggressive on substrates. So it's just kind of giving a bit of an understanding on, you know, on the kind of the science of the products, and then how best to kind of clean a wheel. I mean, I think, yeah, there have been some really good videos out there of people doing that, and that's, yeah, we're looking to replicate that as well.
Cool. Okay, Kofi. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, let's go and have a look at your factory.
Back to order.
Yeah. Lead the way.
Okay. Right.